Book of Esther is what we're looking at, amen. Book of Esther, we're still in chapter 1, and we're looking at Esther. It's an incredible book, a book about God's people, God's providence, God's provision, God's protection, all in this book, and yet the word God isn't in the book. Prayer is not in the book. Temple is not in the book. But how God works things out. Amen. Now, we're looking at chapter 1. We've looked at the king that's here, and he's, of course, holding this feast, and the emphasis is really on the feast that he's held here for those that were at Shushan, the palace. And, of course, this feast is 7 days, verse 5 tells us, something really kind of incredible happens here. At verse 10 and following, we're going to be looking at this. But, this is all just incredible. Think about the provision of God. I'm not sure how old the king is. Ahasuerus is the name we have here. The queen is Vashti. I'm not sure how old they are. But before this is even taking place, God had in his providence, and we'll look at it eventually here, in chapter 2, but in his providence he had a young girl born that becomes Esther. She had to have been born sometime before all this happened so that she could be the young lady that goes on to be the queen that we know is in the story. But, I mean, it's just... God has all these things worked out. God bless you. And it does seem cool in here, does it, to y'all?
Yes.
Tony, sorry about that. Let's see. Oh, boy, they've got it at 68 here, Blaine. Ay, 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 ay.
Keep us awake.
Yeah, huh? Let's just change that. Must have been they were doing lots of exercise in here and they needed it. Do you want me to turn the heat on too? Remember to heat it up? Brother Todd's looking at me like, you gotta be kidding me.
They probably turned it down because of the.
All the bodies that were in here and I don't know what they were doing. All right, let's pray together. Father, I thank you again for your grace and mercy. Thank you for being able to look at your word, and really it's your word that's going to help us. Anything that comes out of my mouth is only something that maybe will help us understand the word. Lord, as we saw in the book of Ezra, that the ones that were there to help, gave meaning to the word, and so that's what I want to be able to do, and I need your Holy Spirit to do that. So please, for the sake of these dear ones, may you just use me in my thoughts and my studies, and we'll thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Esther chapter 1, verse 10. It says this, on the seventh day, and of course on the seventh day refers back to verse 5, where he said he made this feast for 7 days in the court of the garden. On the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine. Now, it's confusing for us because the Bible talks about wine and uses that word, kind of interchanges that word with plain old, good old grape juice and fermented stuff. So if you have grape juice and you hang it around for a while, it gets fermented. Just like you keep cider around for a while, it gets fermented. My wife and I went to visit somebody, and they decided that they were going to give us some orange soda, Mary. And so they brought out these two big glasses of orange soda. And the orange soda hadn't been capped correctly and had no fizz. That should have told her something. And I got it to here. And I went, whoa. So I just, you just taste that little bit. I said to Jeannie, ooh, that's got alcohol. That's spoiled. I don't know, like 20 proof or something. I don't know. And so then, of course, we, we had prayer with her eventually after, you know, talking with her. And then, you know, we went on. Of course, we left these two big glasses of orange soda. And she was kind of, boy, you know, that's kind of a rude thing. They didn't drink any of the orange soda. She said, well, I don't think they touched it, so I think I'll have some. And she got it to here and went, oh, no, I served them alcohol. I served the pastor alcohol. So, but, so, you know, this may have started out, you know, as the as Jesus turned the water into wine. He didn't turn it into fermented juice at all. If somebody had gotten drunk, they could have pointed their finger at that great judgment throne of Christ and said, you made me drunk at that marriage feast. Now, nobody's going to be able to do that. So the Bible often uses the word wine. Sometimes it uses it for grape jelly. Sometimes it uses it for, you know, grape juice. Sometimes it uses it for, you know, alcoholic beverage. A lot of times it'll say strong drink. But so it's hard for, to understand here. And they may have started out with, you know, just wine, but by the seventh day, you know, it got pretty fermented. And his heart's merry. Well, we know that means he's a bit drunk. Now, that wouldn't be a good thing for king, president, you know, any kind of ruler, prime minister, whatever you want to call him. That wouldn't be a good thing. But in the day and age that he lived in, this is what happened to him. His heart was merry with wine. And, of course, he had asked, because of all this merriment of wine, he had asked his wife Vashti, the queen, to come from the house that she was at, entertaining, you know, royal women, to come to the feast so that he could show her off. And this is what's going on here. So he's there, he's merry with wine. Verse 10 goes on and says, he commanded Mahuman, Biztha, Harbona, Bigtha, and Abagtha, Zethar, and Carcass, the seven chamberlains that served in the presence of Ahasuerus, the king. I think I'd have said, hey guys, you know, I don't think I'd have called them all by name. That'd be pretty tough, you know, by the time I get through all of that. Can you see their eyes rolling while I'm trying to pronounce their names? There he is again. I suppose to them it was easy. But he commanded them to bring Vashti the queen before the king with the crown royal to show the people and the princes her beauty, for she was fair to look on. Verse 12 says, but the queen Vashti refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. So, I told you last week that you know, God in his providence made Vashti, this queen, to have some moral fiber to her. And that's part of his provision. He had to do that to move her out so that the Jewish queen could be there. I mean, it's all way ahead of time. You know, God's working all this out. So the chamberlains go, and you see there at verse 11, it says to bring Vashti, the queen, before the king with the crown royal. Now, I don't know if you notice anything there, but after the comma, there's a space. And in that space, there's not the words, you know, the royal robes, the royal shoes, the royal scepter, the royal, you know, coach, the royal horses. Do you see anything else royal except the crown? I've got a blank space. Is that what you've got? All I see is there that she's to come only with the crown royal. That's it. Now, I don't know about any of you ladies in the room, but I think you'd want to wear more than a crown to come before a whole room of men. But that's what he's asking her to do. Is to come, wear the crown so they all know you're the queen, not somebody else. Not an imposter, not just some harlot off the street. But you're the queen, you've got the crown royal on your head. but that's all you've got on. And she said no. She refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Part of the reason she refused, of course, is that she, at verse 9, that she had made a feast for the women in the royal house which belonged to the king. So she's in the house, they're all out in the garden getting drunk, and they want, you know, this to happen. So she refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. Now it's interesting, they must not have had any kind of law that said that she had to obey.
Hmm.
Otherwise, they'd just punished her according to whatever that law was. You know, a lot of times we think that, over there they just treat the women like cattle and that kind of thing, and maybe now they do because they've got the laws that are Sharia law that have come with Mohammedism. But, you know, here they're in Persia, Medo-Persia, and they've got no law against this. Yeah, otherwise, he would have said, hey, the law says she has to. And because then, as we go on to verse 13, then the king said to the wise men, which knew the times, for so was the king's manner toward all that knew law and judgment. Is there law, boys? Hey, fellas, what's in the bylaws? You know, what's the Constitution say here? You know, how do we deal with this? You know, Vashti has said no. How do we deal with this? And then, of course, verse 14, and the next unto him was Karshina, Shethar, Admatha, Tarshish, Merez, Marshina, and Maymukan, the seven princes of Persia and Media, which saw the king's face and which sat the first in the kingdom. So these men that are listed here are like a cabinet, if you will. You know, the president has a cabinet. I don't think he meets with them because he has to find things out in the newspaper. That, you know, he doesn't get mad until he finds out in the newspaper that it's there. So maybe he doesn't meet with, but these, you know, they saw the king's face. You know, they're face to face with him, sits down with him, say, hey, you know, he's wondering, what do we do? So verse 15, what shall we do unto the Queen Vashti according to law? And they've got no answer. There's no law. What shall we do? Because she hath not performed the commandment of the king, Ahasuerus, by the chamberlains. So that's what he asks. What's the law? Yeah. And there's no law on the books. Isn't that incredible to think about?
Hmm.
Well, then we get this guy here, this Maymukan. He's listed last. And I wonder about this guy. After reading what things he says about it, I wonder what his life is like at home. Now, he's the prince, and he's in the cabinet, and he's Mr. Big Shot when he's at Shushan the palace. But when he gets to his home, I wonder who is the one that wears the pants. I think this guy's kind of milquetoast, because he's a little worried here. And he says this, and Maymukan answered before the king and the princes, Vashti the queen hath not done wrong to the king only, but also to all the princes and to all the people that are in all the provinces of the king Ahasuerus. She's not just disobeyed you, but she's made it real scary for every man in this whole kingdom. Because if this gets out, you know, every woman's going to raise up and not obey anything that us men tell them to do, and we're in big trouble. He's in big trouble already, but he's going to be in worse trouble. That's what I kind of get a kick out of this guy. I mean, he's just so. So he says at verse 17, for this deed of the queen shall come abroad unto all women, so that they shall despise their husbands in their eyes. I think he has seen that, and that's why he doesn't want it to happen. He doesn't want it to get out. When it shall be reported The king, Ahasuerus, commanded Vashti, the queen, to be brought in before him, but she came not. Isn't that something? They're not going to tell the whole story. You know, don't tell the whole story that, you know, all us men were drunk and we wanted some, sexual pleasure taken care of here. And so bring in the queen naked with just her crown on. Yeah, the whole story is there. Then she said no. She should have said no. Amen?
Amen.
She should have said no. But, so verse 18, he goes on here, this poor henpecked guy. Likewise shall all the ladies of Persia and Media say this day unto all the king's princes, which have heard of the deed of the queen, thus shall there arise too much contempt and wrath. You know, I mean, he's got to be talking from experience here. You know, he walks in that door, you know, and that's it. I mean, his life is just, whatever she says, he's got to do. He's jumping, whatever she says, jump. On the way up, he's saying, how high, hon? You know, I mean, it just, whew, can you see this guy? You know, he is really worried. So verse 19, if it please the king, let there go a royal commandment from him, and let it be written among the laws of the Persians and the Medes, that it be not altered, that Vashti come no more before King Ahasuerus, and let the king give her royal estate unto another that is better than she. So that's what he says ought to be the law. Now, he's afraid to say, we need to make a law that wives must obey their husbands. Because he knows that's not going to fly at his house. He's going to get a rolling pin in the back of his head if he says that. But let's punish her so that every woman, you know, at least will think about it, that, well, maybe they'll get punished too. It's quite a punishment, you know, that she's banished from ever coming before the king. And the king then is going to take the queenship away from her, give it to someone else. God's word's interesting in that it says, give her royal estate unto another that is better than she. And it goes to Esther. Better than she. Mm. And Vashti, we learned, you know, is that word for the best.
Mm.
And better than she, Esther. Yeah. A lot better. One of God's chosen people. Amen.
Amen.
It says then, verse 20, and when the king's decree, which he shall make, shall be published throughout all his empire, for it is great, all the wives shall give to their husbands honor, both to great and small. And the saying pleased the king and the princes, and the king did according to the word of Memucan. And Memucan's hoping, I think he's just hoping, that his wife, that his wife will give honor to him. Amen? You know, she doesn't now, but he's hoping by this. Verse 22 concludes, for he sent letters into all the king's provinces, into every province according to the writing thereof, and to every people after their language, that every man should bear rule in his own house, and that it should be published according to the language of every people. So this is the thing that went out. And the law of the Medes and the Persians is you can't retract the law. That's the law of the Medes and the Persians. And of course you see that come up in the book of Daniel, where they make the law, no one can ask anything of the king, of anyone other than the king. And if they do, their punishment is, then of lions. And of course, Daniel sees that, hears that, and right away goes and prays, as he always did, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, asking God Almighty, who's really the only one who can give us anything, and who wants to because he loves us. And, then they bring that up to the king, and the king's trying to figure out how can he... But the law of the Medes and the Persians is it can never be changed. It just cannot be changed. At least you can't retract it. You can change it by making another law that's higher than it, supersedes it, but And you can't retract the law. You can't take it back. You can't have it overturned by the court or anything like that. It's law. That's it. The law of the Medes and the Persians. Amen? So this is the thing. Now, one of the things that you need to understand is that Jesus Christ did more to liberate women than anyone ever did.
Amen.
He did so much to make them equal and that kind of thing. And honoring a husband for you wives is something that you do as unto the Lord. That's what the Word of God says. And that's something that you do to please the Lord God. You know, not because you're second class, not because you're a slave, but because you want to please the Lord. And that's a way to do that and to show that. So, you know, we don't need to be writing laws, the Medes and the Persians, that every man should bear rule in his own house. Isn't that something that it said that, but it didn't say anything about the women need to, you know, bow down, anything like that to it. You know, have to obey. So he didn't get the rolling pin in the back of the head. Amen. You came up with that? Can you hear her? You know, his wife had to be something. I really think, you know, here just... You know, Mukin the Milk Toast. That's what his name must have been. And so all of this comes about, though, as part of God's provision. God's working all this so that this Jewish woman can be in there to be able to go before the king at the right time. And it's part of God's provision. It also showed the Jewish people that yes, there can be some morality among people that are not Jewish.
Amen.
Yeah, we have to remember that ourselves. There are a lot of moral people, even though they're lost. They can have great morality. Mm-hmm. Good evening, Devin. Good to see you. And we're in Esther chapter 1 at verse 23 here. And so, we just take a look at all of this because, this is part of God's provision for the people, the Jewish people. See, he knows ahead of time what's happening. And so he's lining up all these things. We just so many times forget that, that God's working without us even seeing it, knowing it for our benefit. And just a great thing. So that's chapter 1. I'm sorry, Devin. you didn't get any of it. But
verse 22, right?
Well, I mean, I'm concluding here. You know, All right, any thoughts or any questions and that kind of thing?
I had a thought as to... her not obeying the command of the king, why she wouldn't have been executed for that, because Esther's fearing to approach the king to make a request. So when someone's commanded, I don't know if it was a command or...
Yeah, it was a command. Yeah, it was commanded, a commandment of the king, Ahasuerus. They must have had a law that if somebody approached the king and he didn't ask them, they would be executed. That must have been a law. But there apparently was no law. What do we do to a queen who says no?
They probably hadn't had it happen.
Remember, a lot of times laws are made because something has gone wrong.
Yeah.
The idea of executing for that, and then word would get out, and that could be the end of Ahasuerus' throne. You know, Xerxes' throne. It's like that kind of guy. Even they wouldn't tolerate a leader like that.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, I mean, when countries have a leader who's that degenerate, that often leads to them being overthrown. It wasn't going to put that liability in her head.
Could be.
But, you know, Esther's going to come before him, and she could have been executed.
Yeah. Yeah, but there was a law in place. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, you know, Vashti is the queen. I mean, that is you know, pretty high, powerful position, so all that kind of thing. All right, Devin, your question.
How would you summarize chapter 1 altogether?
Vashti disobeyed her husband. Yeah, that's, you know, but that was God's provision to move her out. And really, the a great verse in all of that is the end of verse 19, Devin, and we looked at that. It says, and let the king give her royal estate unto another that is better than she. And that's the provision that God had put Esther in, better than she. You know, and she's quite a good woman. And we also looked at verse 11, to bring Vashti the queen before the king with the crown royal. But there's nothing about royal robes, nothing about royal shoes, slippers, there's nothing about royal coach, you know, nothing, just her crown. That's not much to wear, you know. So she said no. Yeah, you're right, John, you know, that's quite a thing. She's afraid, we read later on, but that was a law. You just didn't approach the king unless he held the scepter out to you, and if you did, then you were executed. So, yeah, Mary?
What would have happened to Vashti? Would she have been completely cast out of the palace to fend for herself or whatever, or is she still living in the palace somewhere, but just never before the king again?
Probably just never before the king, yeah, that way, someplace in the palace, but... Yeah, that's it. And she has no more royal power.
Right.
You know, she can't. She's not going to put on parties anymore or anything, you know, that sort of thing. She's not going to be greeting other women that come, you know, as the queen of whatever. She's going to be completely gone that way. Yeah.
And maybe Memucan or
over
there.
Yeah.
He knew the attachment that Ahasuerus had to Vashti, so he didn't have her executed.
Well, that could be.
Because he made up a law. I mean, he could have made up whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So just keep her from appearing before him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and when we get to chapter 2, we're going to see there that, you know, the king remembers Vashti, and, you know, he's like, you know. You know, this isn't so good, and what we did, you know, that wasn't so good. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's why they say, well, let's find someone to replace her, and that kind of thing. But, and that could be, you know, we don't have that spelled out, but that could be that he really did like her. I mean, obviously he made her queen, and all the women that probably he had in his harem, you know, to make her queen, and she was pretty special to him.
Mm.
And so, yeah, that could be, yeah.
Devin didn't hear what her name meant.
Vashti's name means the best. You know, it means the best. And we talked about Memucan here, verse 16. He's one of the princes, you know, that he must have been a henpecked husband. Because of what he says in here, you know, this is going to be bad. You know, all the wives will raise up against us, and, you know, they'll have contempt and wrath. I think he'd seen that at home, you know, a few times already. And they'll despise their husband in their eyes. He's seen that. I think he was talking from experience down through here, you know. So... And at verse 20, when he wanted the king's decree there at the end, all the wives shall give to their husbands honor, you know, both to great and small. That's I think what he wanted, you know, is for his wife to give him some honor. But, you know, he wasn't getting that. So, you know, like I told the folks, you know, he was one thing at Shushan the palace, but boy, when he walked into his house, he was little nothing there. So. Kind of reminds me, the door-to-door salesman knocked on the door, little girl opened the door, said, I want to speak to the man of the house. And she turned around and yelled, Mom!
My mother did that one time. The salesman came to the door and she and Grandma had a little spat. And so the salesman, she opened the door and she said, come on in, my mom wears the pants in this family. Which if you know my mother, she was the meekest person. For her to tell this story just made everybody burst.
Yeah, my dad's not half the man my mom is.
Yeah.
My grandmother was not happy with her.
Oh, yeah. So the providence of God to work all this out, to put a woman that had some morals that would say, no, I'm not going to stand naked in front of all these people that you've got here, drunken men, and have them oogle me and who knows what else. So she said no. She got banished for it. But that way God could put someone in her place that was better than she. Mm. And that's what it was. Yeah. Yes, Devin.
Interesting, because she did something right, you know, morally speaking, you know, mm-hmm. not to show her nakedness, but at the same time punish for it nevertheless.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and sometimes that happens. Sometimes that happened.
This was Xerxes, a drunken fool who went up against Greece and didn't go so well.
Yeah.
He ended up losing the empire anyway.
Anyway.
It might not have been so bad to be banished.
Might not have been so bad, yeah. Yeah, we don't know the whole end of her story, do we?
Mm-hmm.
No, we don't. And it's interesting, Raph, that you bring that up, because between chapter 1 and chapter 2 is when he goes and fights Greece. Mm-hmm. Yeah, between those chapters. Yeah, that's when he goes and fights Greece and loses. And this king, by the way, does have a bad temper. You know, that we saw there at the end of verse 12, you know, therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned him. One of the things that he did is he put together a fleet of warships, mm-hmm. and they went to battle. Where was that? Salamis? I can't remember what the name of a Greek island and all, but the ships were all sunk. And so the king went down with a leather strap and was beating the ocean for sinking his ships. He was trying to spank the ocean.
Wow.
Yeah. Incredible. Yeah, incredible. Okay, dear ones, prayer sheets.